Berks Intercultural Alliance on BCTV is supported by Berks Intercultural Alliance.
Good evening, Reading and Berks County, and welcome to the June 2022 show for the Berks Intercultural Alliance here on Berks Community Television. Welcome you to the show. If you have any questions, please call in. And my name is John Mork, and I'm your host. I'm the president of BICA. And with me tonight, my guest is another BICA member, Dennis Williams.
Good evening.
Dennis is also with Reading Branch NAACP. You chair the health committee?
Yes.
So Dennis knows a lot about health matters, and tonight's topic is systemic racism in healthcare. We've been doing some shows lately about systemic racism and talking about its effect on our society. The effect of systemic racism on healthcare really goes back to slavery. Back in the antebellum times, the slaves were forced to participate in dissections and medical exams. Their graves were robbed as a source of surgical and anatomical experimentation.
Yes.
Runaway slaves were dismembered, had limbs removed. And that was, you know, before the Civil War. In more modern days, the most infamous case of systemic racism in this country is the Tuskegee syphilis study, where black men were intentionally injected with syphilis.
Yes.
And intentionally untreated. And the researchers used these black men as experimental guinea pigs, the way we would use animals in a research lab. You know, it was just an abhorrent, you know, use of human flesh, human beings. And as a result, African Americans have been distrustful of the healthcare system ever since. A lot of abuses and research have happened since then. The Tuskegee research study wasn't the only example. It was the most egregious one that we know of. But the result is African Americans just don't trust doctors, hospitals, and healthcare institutions. And as a result, in many cases, when blacks have the same diseases as whites, they don't get the same care, they don't get the same medicines.
Right.
If Dennis and I had the same illness and went to the same healthcare provider, we wouldn't get the same care. I would get better care, probably better medicines, better treatments than Dennis would. And the only difference on that is the color of her skin.
Correct.
And that's just the way it is in America. And the only explanation for it is systemic racism.
Yes.
Blacks are three times more likely to die of asthma than whites. Blacks have a 25% higher cancer death rate than the whites. Black women have a 20% higher cancer death rate than white women. And blacks tend to develop chronic diseases earlier in life and overall have shorter life expectancies. The average life expectancy for a black man in this country is 71.8 years. For white men, it's 78.
Yes.
Dennis, you know, why don't black people go to the doctor?
It's mainly, it's more than one answer, of course. You know, a lot has to do with stigmas that, just say, speaking on behalf of Black men, the stigma, for example, with prostate conditions. Black men don't want someone to put their finger up there behind, even though it can save their life. It's just a state of mind. It's
homophobia.
It's a lot has to do with numerous issues where they always felt that they can't trust. They can't trust the doctor, man. The doctor might put something up there behind. You know, so there's a lot of mental issues behind just why don't they go to the doctor.
Right.
It's been built up over the years.
And, you know, when there's been so much racism, when you know your people have been abused, when you know you don't get the same level of care, all that is just entrenched in society and the culture.
Yes.
When COVID hit 2.5 years ago, the Black death rate from COVID was double that of whites.
Yes.
And even when the vaccines came out, African Americans were far more likely to not get vaccinated. And it wasn't because of their political beliefs, it was because of distrust of vaccines and the system.
Mm-hmm.
And that resulted in double the death rate. Now, I think one thing that was positive from all that is a lot of the Black community learned that these vaccines for COVID were effective.
Yes.
And a lot of Black leaders, community leaders, doctors, professionals in the community came out imploring their communities to go get vaccinated.
Yes.
And that built some trust.
And consequently, the death rate came down in comparison to white individuals. They were about even par then.
Yeah. That was some major progress. One of the few positive things that came out of the COVID pandemic.
Yes.
So, Dennis, how do we turn this around? What are some solutions that we can implement?
Well, I guess just like we were saying, the COVID vaccines were a step in the right direction where Black families trusted getting the shots. It took a lot of people dying for this trust to begin, but we have to take advantage of it. And I've, just like John was saying about the various illnesses that Black people suffer from, the basic ones are like cancer, hypertension, diabetes, stroke, heart attacks. And then you have this thing where you think, can it get better? What would it take to stem this tide of the high mortality rates for Blacks and in a comparison with whites, almost any disease? What I did was I came up with this idea that I'm gonna work on solutions instead of just looking at all these statistics. And because each year statistics show the same patterns of, and response to these issues in poor communities, like we need more doctors and specialists in the Black community, and we need Black doctors. Of course, that's true. We need to improve access to better health coverage, true. And of course, we need to eliminate systemic racism, which is very true. I have decided to add some positive solutions, even if the solutions sound a little far-fetched, but you know, you can always add or subtract a little bit and maybe you can get favorable results. The first one is we have to deal with food deserts in the various parts of the city. A food desert is a location where people live, but there's no grocery stores. If you don't have transportation, you can't get to a supermarket, so you have to go to the local bodega or a dollar store and get either processed foods or very little choice of fruits and vegetables, and generally, they cost more. So that can cause problems as far as people who are trying to heal. If they're not eating properly, they stay sick. So I recommend that the city start, help the city and the state get together with the health officials and communicate with local food producers and distributors and set up like food stands, or like the farmer's market, St. Joe's has a little farmer's market inside the store, and it starts inside the church, hospital. but we can do this on these vacant lots that local people in different, just say we set up four or five quadrants, and people living in specific quadrants would go to these food deserts, and there would be either, it all depends on how you want to set it up, either trucks handing out boxes of food, or there's actually stands where people can come by and pick out fresh produce. It's close to their home, so they can walk there, or they can be assisted by a family member. I think, you know, John, something like that would work or either along the old UGI building down there on the south side area.
Yeah.
There's a lot.
There are all kinds of areas in the city.
Every area, I believe, has a food desert where there's just a vacant lot.
Yeah.
And when you just do a circumference, there's no stores around. So
there are solutions.
There are, yeah.
Yeah.
And of course, the food would consist of quality fresh fruits, vegetables, and quality meat products. Also, the city and state will provide health information describing the health benefits of preparing home-cooked meals. We could have professional cooks come in from various restaurants who could set up demonstrations of how to prepare fresh foods. And I believe this would increase the confidence of individuals who don't cook very often to cook more and therefore save more money and at the same time healing themselves. So that is one solution. It won't take care of all. It won't heal all. Yeah.
You know, I'm thinking. You know, we used to belong to a CSA, and
CSA was
a community. It's a farm that everything they produced they sold to their members.
Oh, okay, all right.
So, you know, we paid every week, and every week we got a box of produce that the farm produced. And they would oftentimes give us information on how to cook different vegetables and things.
Right,
that were,
right.
In the box, or they had recipes on the website. You know, we went to a place called Jack's Farm down in outside Birdsboro, and but you know, you could do the same thing. When you have these fresh vegetables, you can also hand out sheets that give suggestions on how to cook, prepare, and serve that food.
Right.
Especially, you know, you have something like turnips or something that people aren't familiar with or really know how to use.
Okay, now my second suggestion is to go along with better food distribution and preparation. I think a better understanding of self-love is needed to help people heal themselves spiritually. I mean, physically we may be run down, but spiritually, I think believing and having more faith in yourself can increase your body's ability to heal. So I'm taking a chapter, Matthew chapter 22, verses 37 to 40, when Jesus is talking to the disciples, or maybe going into the being apostles. He says, I give you two commandments that supersede all other commandments. And that is to love God with all your heart, mind, soul, and strength. As it said in the Bible, and to love your neighbor as yourself. Personally, I changed it around to love yourself so you can love others. The emphasis is understanding how important you are to your inner self, like making sacrifices in choices of food. Your old lifestyle may consist of fast foods, sodas, and snacks, which feed diseases, not help to eliminate them. It's important to eat healthy foods and junk foods occasionally, but the whole key is getting a better understanding of love. Loving yourself, to me, means we're composed of a cellular structure, so I feel we should love every cell in our bodies like we love our children, like we love our pets and spouse. You would do anything for them, and we should do anything for ourselves to be healthy, to deal with these chronic illnesses that ravage our communities.
And look how destructive stress is on the body. You know,
oh yes, stress is a big factor.
Stress is a killer
in the Afro community, because of so much pressure trying to make ends meet,
and due to racism.
And right, well, that, you know,
dealing with that day.
Any stress we talk about is going to be dealing with racism. You know,
yes.
It's going to be involved in it.
Yes. Yes. Yeah.
So how is our time, John?
We're good. We've got about 8 minutes left.
Okay. Now this third suggestion is, I guess it's relatively new. My third suggestion is, with this extra money that the state has, I think it's over billions of dollars.
The state is awash in revenue.
Yes. Why not have volunteer DNA heritage testing? Why not use the excess funds to administer these tests, and so people of color can find out what foods their ancestors thrived on and were healthy? Also, it may be valuable for background information for doctors who may give you more accurate meds for your condition. Afro-Americans can also find solace and pride in knowing what country their ancestors originated from, instead of never knowing their history. I think that would be a big boost to their morale.
And, you know? And it just knowing their tribal ancestry and what part, I mean, people don't realize what a huge continent Africa is.
Yes.
And knowing what area they came from, most of them came from West Africa, but still, knowing that heritage, and okay, so this was the diet that these people had, you know, that they thrived on and
right.
stuff. And you know, having that information. Also knowing maybe what diseases are prone to genetically.
Very true, John. Yeah. You figure, they had to be hardy, they had to be strong to endure
that voyage.
That dark, unknown voyage to get here and to be sold and put out in the fields just like that, eating food that their system was not used to.
Yeah. Totally alien to them. Yep.
Well,
they had no corn in Africa back then.
You know, I think corn came with the Indians, didn't
yeah.
it?
Yep.
Yeah.
It was a North American crop. It was unknown to Europe and Africa.
Whoa.
So, all right. We have 4 minutes left.
Okay.
Yeah.
In my summary, John, my solutions may not be on the table for, you know, politicians yet. However, modifying them may work too. For example, offering incentives to black students going to college to major in medicine, nursing, psychology, various therapists, and have some type of mechanism where maybe they won't have to have such a high percentage for their schooling.
Right.
You know, just yeah. some type of incentives
some
to get
subsidizing
yeah.
some of their education.
Right.
You know, I imagine if you're black, you're going to be more trustworthy of a black doctor or black
right.
therapist.
Right.
You know, somebody from your community.
Absolutely. Well, they've done research on that and it shows that black people respond better. They respond in a way where they heal more rapidly when they're seeing a doctor of their own
race.
Color.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, that's just common sense tells you that because of all the mistrust. And really, that's what all this comes down to that we've been talking
trust
about.
Trust and mistrust.
Yes. Is trust in the system. And you know, African Americans will go when they're healthy, they don't go when they're sick because they don't trust the system. And as a result, their outcomes are worse.
They're worse. When they finally do go, they're too far gone to just come back to a normal state of living. It's
yes.
usually relying on medication, and the medication we all know can alter your lifestyle.
And they're worried that medication may be an experimental thing that they're being used as a guinea pig for.
Yes.
I mean, this has happened before. There's a history of it. So that's an inherent
you
underlying
know,
belief and distrust.
You know, quickly, John, one area that, because of that mistrust, black people end up taking medication that is not good for them, and that is with clinical trials.
Right, yeah.
Black
yeah.
people don't want to volunteer for clinical trials yeah. because yeah. they don't trust the system.
Even if the trial is about something like sickle cell anemia.
Right.
They will not participate in clinical trials, and the numbers are very bad. Well, we're out of time. I do want to say, want to dedicate tonight's show to our late treasurer, Sarian Stewart. She died of cancer last month, and we miss her terribly.
Yeah, we really miss Sarah.
Yes.
And that's.
And I guess she's just one more example of the high fatality rate among African American women.
Yeah, we got an example right in our own group.
Yes, yes. you know, we loved Sarah Ann and we miss her terribly, and you know, Dennis and I'll dedicate the show to her, and we appreciate you tuning in tonight, and we will see you again next month. Thank you.